All right, as we begin today, as I said, let's go to Psalm 91. What do most of you have with you today? Because I have both the Amplified and the King James, so. Well, we're just going to have all kinds of things. So, all right, so let's just begin to read along. I think I opened it first to the Amplified, so of course I'm going to be here longer than you are anyway. But as we do this, I want to do this as our, not a prayer like, oh God, do this. It's like an acknowledgement of where we stand in this place today. We're not here petitioning God. We're here speaking what is the truth that God has set in motion for not just his people, but for the whole world. Amen. To come into this place of who he is and what he provides, and that he understands the area in which we've been born and the opposition that we have faced since Genesis. That he understands that we're in the ending of days, and that time is not going to just extend forever from our vantage point like we may have looked at years ago. That surely we had no concept. I grew up in a church that, you know, Jesus was coming soon. You had to be ready today. Well, you know, as a child and as a teenager and all those things, you heard that so much, it was almost like it didn't have impact or meaning anymore. That's not God's fault. It's not the Holy Spirit's fault. It was my fault that I never took seriously even what was coming out of the Word of God and those that God had anointed in the past to walk at least as far as they did in this journey of my life. And then that would apply to each of you as well. That God has been faithful, that God has brought us into these places. He's not lied to us, and he's not lied to anyone. He's been faithful to those who us when we've disbelieved, when we've not done correctly. He has remained sovereignly who he is, totally and fully in love with his creation in each of us. Because it's not just how we exist in this world today, it's the fact that God's will and word was not only written, but presented, hallelujah, and then redeemed in the Lord Jesus Christ. When we were lost from everything, God never forsook us. Even those in the kingdoms that we think didn't have anything going for them because they didn't have the covenant, God was still aware of everyone in that place. God didn't create anything for destruction. He created it to be with him forever. And that's the kind of God that we preach. This is the kind of God that we believe. This is the kind of God who lives in us. And this is his character and nature that has come into our hearts. Hallelujah. Let's begin reading Psalm 91. He who dwells in the secret place of the Most High shall remain stable and fixed under the shadow of the Almighty, whose power no foe can withstand. I will say of the Lord, he is my refuge and my fortress, my God. In him will I lean and rely, and in him I confidently trust. For then he will deliver you from the snare of the fowler and from the deadly pestilence. Then he will cover you with his pinions, and under his wings shall you trust and find refuge. His truth and his faithfulness are a shield and buckler. You shall not be afraid of the terror of night, nor of the arrow, the evil plots and slanders of the wicked that fly by day, nor of the pestilence that stalks in darkness, nor of the destruction and sudden death that surprise and lay waste at noonday. 1,000 may fall at your side and 10,000 at your right hand, but it shall not come near you. Only a spectator shall you be, yourself inaccessible in the secret place of the Most High, as you witness the reward of the wicked. Because you have made the Lord your refuge and the Most High your dwelling place, there shall no evil befall you, nor any plague or calamity come near your tent. For he will give his angels a special charge over you to accompany and defend and preserve you in all your ways of obedience and service. They shall bear you up on their hands, lest you dash your foot against a stone. You shall tread upon the lion and the adder. The young lion and the serpent shall you trample underfoot. Because he has set his love upon me, therefore I will deliver him, and I will set him on high. Because he has known my name, he shall call upon me, and I will answer him. I will be with him in trouble, and I will deliver him, and I will honor him with long life. Will I satisfy and show him my salvation. Father, we bless your great name. Thank you, Jesus, that you have fulfilled and prepared all of these things to continue until time is no more. I bless you, mighty God, in this place. We lift our hearts before you and acknowledge that you are God. Nothing else is God, not our thoughts or our ways. You are God, O Lord. This is your word, and it has not just spoken to us today, but it is spoken from eternity and is still speaking the activity and the meaning of yourself in everything that you have spoken. And we give you praise in this place today. Amen. Hallelujah. 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 Deborah Lee, will you start us off at least through the two mighty fortresses? This first is just setting the stage in a way, but it's still very true.
Our help, the key of this.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. We have thought of your steadfast love, O God. Your right hand is filled with righteousness.
Our God is a consuming fire, a burning holy flame with glory and freedom. Our God is the only righteous judge, ruling over us with kindness and wisdom. Keep our eyes on you. We will keep our eyes on you. A mighty fortress is our God. A sacred refuge is your name. Your kingdom is
Hallelujah. Nanura babata hasata. Oh, we worship you, Lord. We worship you, O God. We are the sound you hear today, Lord God. It's our voice you look for. It's our hearts that you are working in right now, O God. Oh, hallelujah. Thank you for this day. Thank you, O God, not for just promises, but the reality of experiencing you, O God, every day. Hallelujah, from morning to night, and even through the times it seems like they don't exist here. They do, O God. We praise you and give you honor. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Glory to God. And so, you can go on down the line, Deborah Lee, there. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. Just take this time to worship God. Sing to Him. Hallelujah. Get into what you are saying. Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
I raise a hallelujah.
All that being true.
In the presence of
all being happening, what's happening in this world today. And even
I raise
the church,
a hallelujah.
We raise a hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Louder
than the unbelief. Turn that up just a bit.
I raise a hallelujah. My
weapon is a melody.
Keep
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. There's a reason we do these things.
Jesus.
Hallelujah, 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 hallelujah. In some ways, I don't know how we can contain ourselves when we recall the work that God has done and realize that the world that was going on at the time was either in fear because the Savior they had counted on seemed like he was gone. The religious activities of the day, whether they be Jewish or whether they be from the other countries that surrounded and were present often in Jerusalem, that either didn't believe that God meant the Torah and all those things to reveal a son, to reveal Jesus. Sometimes we get stuck and left in our places of what we have believed or what we've grown up with, and we think that that's just how it's going to be forever. But I believe, Pastor Joan, that in this world today, things are changing. Yes, right underneath our nose, if we could say, and truthfully, what I want is our spiritual eyes not to have individual visions of it. I'm not knocking visions, but I mean not trying to but let the Spirit of the Lord reveal in each of us, because God's going to reveal in us according to what his purpose and his plans are in us. He has to deal with things where we have either fallen short, or whether we are lagging behind, or whether we are getting weary because we're considering something to happen, but it doesn't seem like it's going to happen. And he is able to deal with each one of us and all of us together. And if we focused on the fact that a mighty fortress is our God, and that he is what he is, and he is what he is, and he is who he is, and he has done what he has done, and it will not fail. He didn't fail from the beginning. He's not going to fail in the end of this world, because the end of this world only opens up what God has believed from the beginning about you and about I, and also, that's just not good English, but also the whole world. Who we can't have hope for, God has hope for. Who we don't think is worth it, God, God, Jesus' blood is all over him if he'll only receive it. Hallelujah. It's time that we have not only just praise for ourselves or where we are, but an understanding that, hallelujah, everything that we do when we believe God is a thing that causes eternity to be able to be opened up in the eyes and in the hearts of people. Hallelujah, hallelujah. I'm thankful for all the devices we have, but sometimes it's good for us to lay them aside and just hear what God has to say. Even if we think we can say it better, even if we think we can understand it by someone else, God anoints his own word as he will anoint each of you when you speak his word. So it's not a matter of having to be talked to, but it is a matter of handling. You stand in the places that God has always put for men to stand, and that is to hear the word of the Lord. See his activity in the midst. Don't look to yourself, but look to what I am doing. All around the Hebrew children were miracles. They had manna every day. They had fowls coming down from the air. And then they had the marvelous things when the rocks broke open and water flowed out of them. But hallelujah, they should have been in a praise mode all the time. Because even if they felt like they were pressed or they were starving or they were going to thirst, well, we got too long to go before, we don't even know if there is water over there or not. We don't know where we are. Well, truthfully, we don't know where we are. But we don't make up things. We have to see the provision of God by believing him and loving him and knowing from this word not just what he did in the past, but what he did in the past was bringing forth where we are right now. So where we are right now is bringing forth what God is going to do in the next minute, in the next day, in the next year. Hallelujah. Glory to God. Hallelujah. He's not bound by time. He's not bound by age or by how society or anything else looks at us or has thought. He's not bound by evil words that are spoken over us. He's not bound by the hatred that surrounds us. He's not bound by the warfare that tries to take us out. Not before our time, but just take us out, period. Hallelujah. It doesn't matter what day it is. It doesn't matter what time of day it is. But God is ever present. A mighty fortress is our God. A bulwark, never failing. Hallelujah. Glory to God. And I have to ask myself before Him. I don't have to say it to you as a forecast of what I think about everybody else, but I can say it before God for me. Why is it that for this moment I forgot that You are a mighty fortress? Well, God said to me one day, He said, "You don't forget I'm a mighty fortress, but you forget how to enter."
All right.
You forget the way I've opened for you to come. You've forgotten the attitude that I cannot accept, but I will deal with it. But at least you get in the door, and I'll take that away from you.
All right.
Hallelujah.
Amen. Amen.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah.
Thank you, Lord God. Thank you.
Hallelujah. God has said to me several things. I really started out last night with something totally different, and then this morning it was like, where did it go? You know, and of course you first say, oh God, what, you know, I mean, and you know there's things that always come and happen during the day or even in the night or in the early morning to give you a hard time about something, to try to steal your joy. As Audrey Assad sings, he tries to steal, the enemy wants to steal our joy. He wants to steal the awareness of God's presence and the fact that God doesn't change and that He doesn't have to speak to you all the time, tell you what to all right. do, but His presence is what we seek. His voice, if we hear it and then we don't obey it, then we've got a consequence. But His presence will change the way we hear, and it will change our response. Because we don't just pick up these things. We don't just grab a few verses. We don't just get a little things from sermons or Bible studies or wonderful things that are on the internet right now and all the books that are published. Try to get through all those and you'll end up somewhere wondering where God went. But you can live and then enjoy every part of it that God brings to you. Hallelujah. The way you approach a book, the way you approach what you hear so you can grab it to employ it or tell it to somebody else, you've missed His presence. You've missed the power of God. You've missed the blood of God cleansing you in the midst of these things. It isn't a matter of trying to present yourself or present something of God that he doesn't know how to get across. Hallelujah. I know you. I'm not even going to say that because God said to me, I don't think that. Our wilderness exposes our weaknesses. It always has and it always will.
Yes. Yes.
It is the nature of every wilderness to create an experience where we understand the difference between the wilderness and God's will for our lives. When we consider that we are not only a servant of Christ, but a son in Jesus, we will walk and we will walk one day into every season. We'll walk through it in it helpless, but we're no longer afraid. I don't know if I wrote that down right, but I didn't read what I wrote, thankfully. But anyway, there are often times it seems to us that we don't have what it will take to survive. Sometimes we don't think it's going to take as much as it does. We think any moment now we'll be free of all these things and we won't have anything yet to worry for. But you know, what I would say in this and what I hear in the midst of me is that, I don't know if it's a scripture or whether it's a song, spring up, oh well. Spring up, oh well. Because what that means to me, and well, of course, coming from the era I lived in, I was used to getting water out of a well, you know, doing the cranking back on the farm and all those kinds of things, too. I did live in the city, but I had grandparents that were farmers. But to realize that God doesn't lie. And when you read those scriptures, and you see, you've got to read His Word. It's not just a matter of listening to me. It's a matter you need to read them, not to get information for yourself, because you're listening to God speak something to you that truthfully you don't understand in its fullness. But the power of it is greater than anything you could do that looked like you had some control over a matter. But what I understand... And there have been places over these last few months, maybe even years, that I've had those feelings like it seemed like that I didn't have what it took to survive. And the truth of the matter, God said, you don't.
That's it. That's right.
When you get into those kinds of modes of thinking and, oh, woe is me, then you're looking to yourself, calling upon yourself, listening to yourself. What have I said to you? And we can quote words back to the Lord, like, I'm with you always, I'll never leave you, I'll never forsake you, I'll never forsake you. Five times He repeats it in each of those verses. And at a time when we're using it, it seems like we're pulling on it, we're crying, we're going all through these motions. But the revelation of those things is what we need, not the words. We need the revelation of the one who's saying them. That this is God who has said this. Well, if some of said this just wasn't real. Some side said that didn't really happen. Say that, well, they don't have the right doctrine. Forget all that. This is God. Hallelujah. And when you get into that word, I remember, because I grew up in a Christian home. I grew up in preachers' homes, and I grew up with people who lived it, but also grew up with people who failed and repented and came back. So it's like it's not a matter of trying to have some perfect activity. It's a matter, and even in those places, I realized that I couldn't live off of their coattails. I couldn't live off of their titles. I couldn't live off of their talents. I couldn't live off of their ability to wield the Word of God by the power of the Holy Spirit. But hallelujah, God's presence in each of us is what does that. Amen. I thank God for them, because in the times, and then it covered a great periods of time, even in Christianity as well as the time in the earth, but even so, and it may seem kind of simple now if you read some of the things, but when you look in there, hallelujah, God says, I used that. I used that. I used that. And I will use that today, because it's not dependent so much on the person who speaks, but who believes the God who has spoken it. Because sometimes we can speak a thing and we believe it, but then we look and see if somebody wavers in it. We look at their wavering rather than the power of God, rather than praying for them, standing to hold the Word of God, unfailing and unerring and full of power and able to do all these things. Hallelujah. And we can see it because God spoke these things before He put the world into existence. So His Word holds everything together, and He holds everything about you together. Praise God. Hallelujah. That was really not even where it was going. It just happened to be where the book had fallen open. But I'm not sure, and I'm just going to, I know nobody likes that. You like somebody just to roll on with the, so you can get in the flow of something. Well, I live, and I have to live in the flow of something. I have to live in the face of all kinds of things. I have to live in the face of things that I just sometimes look and think, really? You know, and when I do that, as if I'm making a judgment on that thing, God says to me, nothing. I just feel Him look at me. You know, are you going to stay there? What could you say to me? What could you believe? And sometimes we want to straighten out other people's lives, but you know the truth of the matter, they may be right on track. If we'll just wait, God's going to do what he meant to do. But he has to, makes the roads we travel.
That's right.
And where we begin to see and understand him in those places and acknowledge, because God tells you things sometimes that they're not the answers you want. He takes you somewhere that you think, well, okay, I'm you know, you're really excited about it, but how did you get through? How did that answer my question? God isn't about answering our questions. He's about proving that he knows who we are. And he has to break us free of all the things that have tried to change our opinions about God and about his faithfulness and all those kinds of things. I woke up this morning with a, you know, I'm thinking, whoo. I'm not sure what happened in the night, because I went to bed, you know, really confident and sure. I woke up in the morning thinking, where am I? You say, that's just your old age. Well, maybe, maybe not. Hebrews chapter 10, verse 7. And I'm just going to skip around a few things. God just said, do it. He said, I'll put it together in the hearts that will hear. And I have to believe him. I can't believe that I'm the one that's supposed to get it, the script written for you, and you follow that script and you're never going to fail. No. Hallelujah. He writes this same word to all of us, but he applies it according to how he knows us.
Yes.
God has chosen you and made you. He has, we say, a calling on our lives. We think that's like your calling to be a preacher. It may be. But the calling is to himself.
That's right.
To know him,
that's
because
right.
He's the only one who knows who you are.
Right.
He's the only one. It says in Psalm 139 that before the foundations of the world, God had already written our lives. In the book, and the word that's used in the King James is the word continuance. And we think, well, that's just, you know, it's not, it's without end. It just, no, God wrote it in continuance because it was going to go through a lot of stuff that was going to try to take it out of this world and out of the kingdom and out of God's hands. He wrote it with such power and authority. Because you see, this world is not... back in my day, we would sing songs like this world is not my home, I'm just a passing through. And we sang it like that because I was born in the country. But anyway, what we miss when we sing that is because we take it surfacely. But it's true. This earth is for a purpose. You're here for a purpose. Mm-hmm. And there are things that God has written and meant and will do and anoint you with and gift you with and has by the power of the Lord Jesus' life in you and by the power of the Holy Spirit. Hallelujah. And you say, well, what happens to those who don't know him? God doesn't ever forget. There'll come a time when all of us will face a relationship with God that we're not going to turn down. Mm-hmm. There's nobody that can say it's not important, it's just a tomfoolery, or that's an old word, but just foolish. But God will say in your heart, you know, right now, all the things that you think got you here can't get you any further than where you are right now. But I've got something purposed. Now, what I want to do is believe God, love him, and let his love and let his, we'll maybe get to that song, I don't know. We're going to let his love do the work that he wants to do. And it will continue beyond our a problem in our life yesterday or today or 3 days from now. He's not just there as a problem solver. And sometimes it looks like he didn't even solve your problem. Because your problem wasn't your problem. It was the way you dealt with him or you didn't deal with him that caused you to step into those places you shouldn't have been in the first place. And they have made the hassle in your life. They have made the things a trial to your life. And God's saying, now you're going to have to walk with me. And he wants you to walk out of them. He may set you free from the power of it, but you have to let him walk with you so you can lose the memory of the stronghold the enemy got in your life. I don't know if we have time to talk about, but that was just so prevalent in me at some point. I was looking at the Greek words concerning the definition of Satan, S-A-T-A-N, one of the names of the devil, Lucifer, the angel of darkness. And, you know, even things we take as stories, they're important for us to know how to live. When we understand what God has done to keep us, we're not going to be so lackadaisical. Our TVs and our phones and our internets and our everything else that we have let take places in our lives that seem to be more important than letting God speak to us. And sometimes it's not a matter, it's just yielding yourself to being in His presence. Because there have been times when I've said, okay, you know, I have time now. I have time now. God's just as pleased with me when I don't have any time, when He can speak to me and I hear Him. Amen. He doesn't care that it makes me cry in the middle of a grocery store. Well, that's just old ladyish. Well, maybe it is. I don't want to be hard anymore. I don't want to be this surface thing that knows everything, can just speak eloquently and have all these background things and tell you how wise I am. That eternity will reveal how wise we were, not ourselves. Because even in the greatest wisdom within you, you can err and you can fall. And if you know Him personally, then you're not going to think your life is shattered. You're going to have to bow before Him and say, God, You know how I got here. You know how to get me out. But in the meantime, thank You for Your blood. Thank You for saving me. Thank You for delivering me. Thank You for cleansing me. People can look at me any way they want to, but I only want to see the love of Jesus. I only want to see Jesus on the cross. I want to see Him sitting at the right hand of the Father. Cross, not just for you, but for everything in everyone's life that was going to try to put them on a detour that would cause them to turn away in probably the greatest hour that seems like nothing to anybody else. So that you won't believe God, and the devil will continue to begin to pound and keep pounding in your mind and make, that's what the devil does. It was as I was saying, I was looking at these things, and one of the things I didn't even realize in that word diabolos, God gives him several different names, but in that activity, coming from the standpoint of the, it basically means it's a combination of two Greek words, but the word, the last section of the word is dia, D-I-A, and in it's diabolos dia. And what that means, it shows an activity, and that dia is an activity of the enemy that does this. He just reaches in everything that he can reach into to attack you or someone, and he just begins to sling it. And he doesn't just stop and wait to see if it hit. He keeps slinging it and slinging it and slinging it until he sees a response in us that we have believed that lie, that we have chosen the lie rather than God. And then he begins to work on that and tell you lies and add to that thing and twist that thing to the point where that even faced with the truth, you would rather believe that lie about someone, about God, about a situation or a circumstance or whatever, that you want to believe that thing rather than God.
All right.
That's why you see how mighty it is that you have on the armor of God.
That's right.
That is not just some little petty thing that you put on. Well, I've got my armor on today. I'm going out. You know, I got on and I realized, I thought, why did you wear this sweater? It doesn't even, I didn't have time to change. I'd already made this decision. And Nina was almost at the door to pick me up, you know. But it's like those are just things you can't use. I believe the lie about this thing. I can't even imagine what it's caused in the kingdom of God and in the lives of other people because I've had this attitude. I couldn't even receive what you were saying. I couldn't even see beyond that attitude I had against, but that's what it does. That's why we don't know how to forgive. That's how we don't know how to let go of something. We can see somebody in suffering, and yet we can begin to scold them and put them in place rather than to pray for their suffering. We say we want healing, we want deliverance, we want them not to be bound, but we inside there's something in us that has to be satisfied. And I'm telling you, even their healing and their deliverance will not change that stronghold. It's when you decide that God's greater than whatever's been done to you. And you probably have done just as bad to somebody else or just as bad to what God has meant for you for years. Some of you aren't as old as I am, but it doesn't matter. God still has to restore the lost years in our lives, the lost things in our lives that we just continued on and didn't really believe God. Well, can anybody just live that way? Living means that we're going to have to fight all the time. But it isn't fight one another, and it isn't fight against God. And it really isn't have to pay too much to the attention. We're going to have to keep our eyes on Him. We're going to have to be renewed in the spirit of our mind, not just renew our mind. You can read this word and have all the right answers, but that doesn't mean you have renewed in the spirit of your mind. You've renewed in the things that you can quote back, but there is a spirit of your mind, the spirit of the Lord Jesus Christ, the spirit of the Holy Ghost, the spirit that's in this word, hallelujah, that has power to cause things to you to be able to think God thoughts and respond to God thoughts and not just think God's words and say they're His thoughts, but you can't do them except you perform them in the same manner that you would just do, you know, go in and cook a recipe. Praise God. Well, I don't know where we're going here, but we'll just be here for a little bit and then we'll be through. But in Hebrews 10, and I got as far as Colossians. Give me credit. Oh, hallelujah. Hebrews chapter 10. This is the scripture that stood out to me. And I've got one of these two versions in one thing, so I never know where everything is. Verse 7. Okay. 11 is almost 10, but it's not 10. All right. So I'm going to read this first in the King James, and then I'll just cross over to the other page and read it in the Amplified. And then, of course, Paul is writing here about various things. And when you come to the places, and I thought I've come to all these places, but God said, nope, you got further to go. Okay, just keep on coming. You know how I got that. And if you need to preach about it, and then God, you know, in two or three weeks, He adds something else. You think, oh gosh, I didn't get all that. But he's not making us. It's us that wants to think we have everything. But rather than to see that God is so greater, much greater than we are, that we can't contain even a thumbnail of His wisdom, but He gives it to you in proportions. And when we believe in it and begin to act in it, then other things open up. And I believe that's what the body of Christ as a whole perhaps has missed. Not everyone, but some. Chapter 10, verse 7, Hebrews says, then said I, lo, I come in the volume of the book as it is written of me to do thy will, O God. In the Amplified it says, then I said, this is Jesus speaking, behold, here I am, coming to do your will, O God, to fulfill what is written of me in the volume of the book. You say, well, what does that mean? Well, we know that we can look in some of the other translations even. It says, in the scroll of the book, wherein it is written of me, or predicted and fulfilled in me what God had written, what God had said and put down for men to see. I actually fulfilled not just something that was written of me, but I was the force and the power, yes. And I was God even as He wrote me, because what has been written is me. Amen. He's written of Amen. Me Amen. In the volume of this book. I did the work. Hallelujah. Now, what I'm asking you to do may seem like work, but it's only work because you're fighting against darkness when light is trying to penetrate the darkness, when God is trying to penetrate the strongholds of the enemy in our lives. And I didn't know I was even going to get to that point, but I don't know how to say this. I had written this down. I looked at this. It was in this book, so I hadn't really looked at it before. And I looked at this, and I thought, I don't even know what I said. I guess what I want us to remember is that when you were born, through the activity of your mom and dad in producing a seed and an egg, so to speak, and you became a living soul in the activity of being in the womb of your mother, and that's just the way it is. I don't have anybody's school book on this. I have the Word of God on this. And when you're there, that's why when I was speaking, let me just read it quickly, Psalm 139. It's not the only place. You can look several places in the Old Testament, which God had made record of this before Jesus ever came. But it says in Psalm 139, let's just start reading in verse 1. Amplified is what I have here. O Lord, you have searched me thoroughly and have known me. You know my down sittings and my uprisings. You understand my thought afar off. Do you realize that God, you're not out there just thinking and you're coming up with something for yourself, that really God knows what you're thinking and he can help you with your thoughts. You sift and search out my path. In other words, God did something for each one of us long before we ever existed, but we existed in him. We existed in his heart. We existed in his mind. We existed in his will and his plan to overcome what Satan was trying to do. You think, well, why did he create Satan? Because God cannot lie against himself. He saw, it said, he saw this in him from before the foundations of the world, but he couldn't just snatch him out or he would change everything. He would just go around. If he didn't like me today, I'd be gone. I'm here. And he has not liked me many days, I'm sure. In many places and in many times. But because he is love and he is light, he is never going, he's going to overpower the darkness, which that's what Satan was doing. He was taking being a former Star Trek fanatic, he was on the dark side, if I can put it that way. But all of these things, when we realize this, that God has known what to do, he's God. He's not a figment of our imagination. He is not a theory out there. You and I are not God. It doesn't take long, Pastor Joan, to realize I couldn't figure out what to do for you, let alone myself in a place, if I was just left to that without anything else. So if I'm just a man, if I'm just a woman, if I'm just a human being and I'm born to have a life here on this earth and when I die, then why is it that we want to choose darkness rather than light? What appeals to us from the dark when we don't realize that we were created by light? We were created by love, not hatred. Mm-hmm. Satan doesn't love anything, except that he loves to try to destroy you and I because he hates God. It isn't because he loves us. It's because he hates God. Because he wanted to take God's place. He thought he could do something faster and better than God was going to do it. But he didn't. He was a created being, just like we are. So he could not take that place. And we can't take that place. Hallelujah. Glory to God. But let me just, because I do want to say this, because what he's describing here is he's coming to a revelation. David's looking at this, and the Spirit of the Lord is working, and he's coming to see some things about the God he's out with there in the shepherd fields, and looking up into the heavens, and he was like an unwanted child. He was a bastard, David was, and he was out there because he was not one of the his brothers and all this sort of stuff, and yet it was David that God chose out of all his brothers and out of that family line. He was in the right family line, but that was all. But he chose him and said, you are the one I've waited for. And he made him king over Israel, because what, regardless of what men do right or wrong, God is still going to use them to get done, because God will forgive. And if you and I can't forgive, then when did I become God? When did you become God? If we can't forgive, hallelujah. Because there are things that happen to us in our lives that make us think that we're all by ourselves and that we weren't, you know, but we can come out of those places. Even if people don't like us, even if we have been abused or mistreated, we can come out of those places. Even when those that we trusted lied to us and proved false, it's not them that our life is in, it's in God. So we can forgive. And in that place of forgiveness, we're in such a powerful place, because God is the only one that can forgive except you and I. In Christ Jesus, he made us able also to forgive, and we begin to operate in a realm that will destroy the darkness and bring the love and the light of God to a full healing power in us. Okay. Well, I'm so used to reading or quoting it, I can't find which verse it's in. Here it is. Let's start looking. David is seeing these things as he's looking up into the heavens, perhaps. He's seeing verse 14. It says, you did four in 13, for you did four my inward parts. You did knit me together in my mother's womb. And if we went before that, I'm just going to quit trying to shorten it here. Verse 9, it says, if I take the wings of the morning or dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand lead me and your right hand shall hold me. You and I have to know today, us who are older, we have to know it. And it's not because we've done everything right, it's because God is right. And so if we are believing that he can lead us and that he holds us, then we have to believe that he needs to correct us and bring us into a place where we are not a constant prey for the things in ourselves that are in places of darkness because of strongholds or because someone else has laid something upon us that wasn't ours. Yeah. It says, verse 11, it says, if I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the night shall be the only light about me. But, he said, the darkness hides nothing from you. The night shines as the day when I'm with you. The darkness and the light are both alike to you. Because God is not darkness, he just knows the darkness. But because he is the light, he can see into the darkness and bring light to it. And when we talk about the darkness, we are talking about the realm of evil, the realm of Satan, but it's also the things we don't know. Because sometimes it's not because we're evil, it's we didn't know. We only got so much information, or somebody's just telling us that, and that's what we believed. And God says, I know some things that I could speak to you about. For you did form my inward parts, you did knit me together in my mother's womb. And out of that, he said, I will confess and praise you, for you are fearfully and wonderful. And for the awful wonder of my birth, and the awe, and it's awe-filled, the awe-filled, not awful as bad, but awe-filled wonder of my birth. Yeah. And that's why we stand the way we do, because it says in verse 15, it says, my frame was not hidden from you when I was being formed in secret, and intricately and curiously wrought, as if embroidered with various colors in the depths of the earth, a region of darkness and mystery. Your eyes saw my unformed substance, and in your book all the days of my life were written. Hallelujah. Before there even one of them ever took shape, when as yet there was none of me to be existing. How precious and weighty also are your thoughts to me, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I could count them, they would be more in number than the sands of the sea. And when I woke, I couldn't count to the end. Even if I could count to the end, I'd still be with you. Hallelujah. That's the God who has loved us. So, praise God. I don't know how all this fits together. I've long since tried to make something that just was, that I could be republished in a book. If that's my reason for being and my reason for speaking, I have failed. Hallelujah. Because in the day we live, we have a proliferation of books, and it's not that there isn't truth in all of them, but sometimes they become, we don't know how to discern the places where that it applies to us. And it may apply to us, but it may not apply to everyone else in the same way it applies to us. So we have to be careful when we try to teach from a book to understand the heart of God and to see His great love for us. And see that very easily when we're in a place, especially in the fivefold ministry, it's very easy to be in places where you have the responsibility to, we say, judge or to oversee something, that we don't oversee it from the perspective of where we are, but we oversee it in the love of God for where He sees and what He's called, not just the whole, but all of us to stand in these places. Sometimes we write people off, and God did not. And so sometimes we put in a burden. Sometimes we don't really believe how much God can forgive. We want Him to forgive us. We want Him to blot out things. I don't know how to say this. I'm just tracking with the Spirit right here. It's not a matter. What I want to say is this one thing. God is constantly, when we are with Him, opening up to us, not exclusively to us. All things have to be made checks and balance, because you and I can still hear some things from our old perspectives. Yeah. So what we want to do is that when God begins to deal with us over matters, we need to humble ourselves. That's a word we don't like. We want everybody else to do it. And we want to tell Him we're humbling ourselves before Him. But the minute He doesn't speak right in the vein we want Him to, we're back up on our, yeah, but what? You know, if you'll see as you read His interaction with all of those that wrote, had a hand in writing the word, they had a relationship with the Spirit of God. They could even hear the negative without challenging God. They could put it down just as it was and then let Him reveal it to them. Sometimes things were written at certain places for certain times, but those times will come again because we live in time and time cycles again. So those things will always apply, but we should have as a church, and that's not true, unfortunately. We should have as the church and as members of the church, every one of us grown to points and measures, you know, that we can live in the grace that God has given to us. And that's so powerful, even from the way I used to understand grace. But as God shows me more and more about it, grace is still powerful because that's still its name. But when He says it's light that has the ability, the power, to not just separate you from darkness, but to cause that darkness to have no more effect. Mm-hmm. not just in your life, mm-hmm. but because we believe it, and because we believe it as a body, not just this body, but as the whole body of Christ all over the world. We're not just one. There are others that believe what God is speaking to us. When we believe that, we're in the presence. We're above these areas. We're above this thing, and we're in a heavenly realm. We've already, that's an activity of God I don't know how to describe, but we got all kinds of battles to fight here. But those battles are not, we're not just going bonk, bonk, bonk. Some of us are in the midst of it at various times, and it seems like we're wounded, we're mortally wounded. It seems like all of these things. But here again, God help me to say, I'm standing right there. I used to think that words were the most important things. But God said, words are not important. What I have spoken lives. What I have spoken heals. What I have spoken will make righteous. What I've spoken will make, it's what I have spoken. And you can't come from your mind and think that you can speak my words. Humble yourself. That even if you seem like you speak them one way and that's right and you get results, don't be stopped there, because I'm going to bring you further, because God wants to bring all of us who are made in His image and His likeness into His thoughts, not our minds, not our intellectual ability, but into God's mind and heart, which is His ways are higher than our ways. He needs for us to speak, even though we're speaking words that people can understand, to have a thought process that God can put our words in His thought process, and they're not going forth to you as if they're coming from what I've experienced or what I know, but really what God has done, and I believe that He's done it. I may not have seen the fulfillment of it in my life, but I believe it, and that's where our faith is. It's before we see it, is that's faith working. That's faith working. This is faith working in me today. It's faith working in you. And I don't really care anymore if you think this is too high for you. It's God in you calling you up. It's God in me calling me up, not so I can become a scholar, but so I can walk humbly with our God. We can walk humbly with our God. And we may be the low person on the totem pole in somebody else's eyes, but if we walk humbly, we can help them from to not fall.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We have to, there's an activity in us, and I can't get it today because it's getting too long. But there's an activity in us, I know, that's important, that we think it is, it's like us. We resist the enemy. Well, I rebuke the enemy. You got to know what he's doing to you so you know what to rebuke him about.
That's right.
If you don't know what he's doing with what he's got in your mind working, then you can't rebuke him. You're just trying to use some kind of a chant. I don't know anything about the book you're doing, but that's witchcraft when you're trying to use the things of God when you don't even know. You're not using them. You're using them toward the enemy, but it's his work in you that needs to be dealt with.
All right. Amen.
That's right.
Amen.
It's one of the reasons I don't go in and read the book is because God told me to let her do what he told her to do. And you know, the other thing is, if I'm not an overseer. Yep. We work together. Mm-hmm. And I will trust God. Mm-hmm. Do I get fought about it? I do. Do I have to overcome things? I do. But hallelujah. If we have not believed God, why are we here? Where are we? We don't have to know why everything has happened the way it happened and all those things. But there will become places where God will cause things to happen. And you will not make peace. They won't be your choice. You won't say, God, let me have peace about this. Well, he'll give you peace. He gave you some peace already. Mm-hmm. Are you using it?
Amen.
Are you just are you using it there? Well, yeah, I've got all the words, but I've got to say this. They didn't do. No, you don't got to say that. That's the work of the enemy. To say that God has not done a work in somebody else because it isn't just like yours.
All right.
Hallelujah. Glory to God. Well, I'm kind of wandering today. But I got up this morning in Wonderland, like wandering land, I mean. Oh, there was something God. Yes. I had some things fall out of a book that I'd been cleaning. Don't ever clean. You never find anything again. Oh, it'll be better over in here. I'll file it in this. Oh, whoa. That's just like, oh my God. Oh God, you told me this. And if you go to my room right now, my bed looks just like that. Oh, Nina saved me. I'd still probably been there. This is a word the Lord gave to me in the beginning of June, in 2019. I reconstruct the hearing of my people, and the speaking of my own will advance in frequencies of sound of many waters. In other words, the words that we speak are just not what you're hearing me. There's something in us that speaks at the frequency of the sound of many waters. It flows through the universe. It flows up into the heavens. Hallelujah. God directs the angels, all those kinds of things. We live in a wondrous place. That's why I no longer idolize Star Trek and all those places. I acknowledge that I was a great fan and I had all their plates and all their figures and all their books and all that stuff. But I don't live there anymore. God allowed that for a time, but then he said, I'm greater than they are. Those adventures are only fantasies of the reality of where you actually, I know you to be, not just in time, not just in space somewhere, but in eternity. Because you've got to believe me that there'll come a time when this earth will pass away and time will be rolled up into that, and I will open the books that I have written before the foundations of the world, and you will be with me.
Right.
Make sure you're my own. They're a reason why words come to us. They're not to become our doctrine, but God will bring them in at the time appointed to where they're alive to us, and we think, oh my gosh, I put it over here. I was thinking about it, but me. No, there's something about us that belongs to God that we don't know. And he said that those words, he's going to reconstruct our hearing so that we can understand they are actually doing something.
That's right.
And I now release over the whole earth in June of 2019 to speak the reality of worship, the reality of prayer, the reality of intercession, and the definition of kingdom paths. These are paths. These are light waves. These are light rays of God that move in our lives today in Christ Jesus and in the Holy Spirit and in the Word of God. There are paths being released to see, walk, rejoice, and again, yes, but also I say to gain. You will be released and filled with joy, but there is gain. And I won't read this all, but he said, from the four corners of the earth, you will see it come.
Messiah, yes, Lord.
You must believe it, but you will see it come from the four corners of the earth. It's important when you know how God has made the universe and how he speaks of things. And I don't have time to lecture. I don't think I have the ability to do it without the Holy Spirit anymore. I've lost some of those things. And I don't know if I lost them because of my negligence or if I lost them because I had trusted in them rather than allowing the Holy Spirit to do what he wanted to do. And to bring not only everyone but me in the place that he means me to be for these days. The other thing that I, the two things, those that was one, there were three things. This was another one. This was from Mario Morello. God yearns to reveal himself as a mighty warrior on behalf of those who will take the time to become armed and dangerous.
Grab it.
Oh my Lord.
Hallelujah.
Pastor Sharon.
Yes, I'm.
Lord spoke to me yesterday, had me speak words out of my mouth again. Mm-hmm, mm-hmm. He said, after the Bible study, he said, these are armed and dangerous. You're armed and dangerous. Hallelujah. You're armed and dangerous. Oh, Mashiach.
Hallelujah.
Undoubtable Mashiach. Oh, my God.
Hallelujah. Hallelujah. I'll let that stand. I won't continue as I was going to. Oh. But I will open this. This is from the latter part of the Maskil. God gave that to me in 1990 in this place. He told me this morning, read this. I preface, this is actually the paper I first typed it up on. This is on the second page. I didn't bring the other page, so I wouldn't be tempted. The other one, unfortunately, has a bigger picture, but I have to read it from this little tiny print. The Maskil, which is an activity of a title for the Psalms, basically means understanding. It comes from another word which means to be prudent and diligent in seeking insight and understanding. Even with those words of being armed and dangerous, we have to be careful not to think that we know what being armed and dangerous is. Amen. To God in every situation. Mm-hmm. It's a relationship with him. Amen. It's an understanding of him. Amen. That makes us armed and dangerous. Amen. The enemy doesn't know what we're doing then. See, so we're not just taking, we've got something to know. No, we've got something already, but he is bringing it into a place where it works with him and not according to what we see with our eyes. Or hear with our ears.
Hallelujah.
However, as God opens this to us, 1990, and maybe he just did it to me. I tried to pass it on to you guys, but we see it to be directly related to having God's perspective on all things and our being able to deal properly and pleasingly to him. It is definitely a heavenly comprehension and participation in the vision and wisdom of God that comes because love, because it loves and seeks God's will and his way above our own. It says there are 13 Psalms with the Maskil, and I won't read them all here, in their superscription. They're also called the didactic psalms, meaning they are teaching psalms. These are places, these are the kinds of the Maskil are teaching. So there are things in there that don't have to do with teaching you, but they have you to teaching about God's love and about God's ways. One writer feels these psalms give a course of instruction for the sons of the kingdom. At that point in time, I was beginning to see the opening of the kingdom of God more than just the church realm or church membership or something being created or coming to existence, even in light of the world at that point. It was something that was kingdom. It wasn't. It was going to be fought. It was going to be dealt with. It was, and by that, I didn't think about anybody else but me. I'm sorry. I was going to be fought. I was going to be dealt with. I was going to be have to come through some burnings and fires and cleansings and testings. I was going to have to be changed. So I never wrote this as if it was just for everybody. I wrote it because God, and like I said, it's a two-page thing, and I only have the last part of it here. It says, in this psalm for the 1990s, this is what God gave me, is God's perspective on the times ahead. I thought, God, you gave us these perspectives, and how many times were they far from my thoughts? I can't say anything about anybody else's, because we thought we knew more. But when we think we know more, even when God is telling us more, there are ways we have to walk in, because these are paths of light. These are ways of His dealings. And that's where, when we don't deal consistently, when we're tempted to deal another way, then it becomes a transgression rather than a healing. It's times ahead for His answers for things of the kingdom. God's wisdom and understanding. See, I thought I knew all about God's wisdom, God's understanding. I look at that and I think, God, what did I even know concerning what I can see now? And now I don't even know that. I realize there's just more. It increases. It isn't up here in your mind. It's the spirit activity that will be worked in us and is being worked in us until these words and many more are true. See, I forgot those things. Going to work these things until they're literally true in senses that we're not understanding. Because it's not, God knows. And the enemy knows when things get true in us, or when we're just talking, when we're just hoping, when we're just setting stage. But He's going to work on us not being armed and dangerous. He is speaking that you're listening to a prophet. She's saying, God said, they are armed and dangerous. That's how God sees you. Well, the enemy doesn't want you to see yourself that way and wants you to get out of the places that will cause you to be armed and dangerous. That's what I'm trying to say. I'm not against anything. I'm just saying, this is what I see about God, is that we have to walk at a different level than we ever have before. And that level is not on our own goodness, that's for sure. By grace are you saved through faith, and that not of yourself, it is a gift of God. So, you know, by faith are you armed and dangerous, and that not of yourself, it is a gift of God. Hallelujah. Our true revelation affecting every area of existence in the heavens, on the earth, and under the earth, even to places and peoples we do not know, but God does.
Hallelujah. Bless God. Bless God. Hallelujah.
In this also is God's instruction to us to avail ourselves of all He is offering and requiring. We want what He offers, but we sometimes balk at what He requires as we receive what He offers. It also serves as a declaration of the Almighty God of what He sees and knows. Therefore, it should be what we see and know. And we can't just see it that day. It is something that will become, it will become superior in the sense that it will become heavenly. It will become spiritual. Hallelujah. In the midst of these failing and fading earthy things. Overcomers who've been overcome. Holy blood, my whole sum. You're in my hands, and I hold the keys. Come now and take your place. You're no earthly race. Holy vision, drawing near. Holy seed, ones with no fear. Rising up and dressed in white, signs and wonders soon to take flight. In other words, you're going to move in the spirit, and not just in just the earthly realms. bringing glory to me through all eternity.
Amen.
I've given you my cross and commanded you to come. I will open you up and my blood will run as an open show before the enemy, triumphing over powers and principalities. As it is written, so it will be done. The last generation has come. This is my hope. This is my call. This is my faith put forth to all. With these words, I will identify. I will come to mark and claim my bride. Make sure you're my own, for only holy stands at the throne. Hallelujah. Praise God. Hallelujah. These are things, and they are just so full of even things we don't yet see or understand, but we are in the midst of them, and we have grown. We have made progress.
Amen.
Don't think you're back in diapers in the cradle roll.
That's right.
You're not.
That's right.
Hallelujah. You may have been fought to where you feel like you've been stripped of all the things you had, but praise God, maybe you didn't need those. Now you put on the trueness of righteousness of the kingdom of God and the God's armor in Christ.
Amen.
Hallelujah. We did have to change our clothing inside and out. We do have to be reclothed and redressed. Hallelujah. Something God said, and I don't remember the whole thing, but he just said to me, he said to me last night as I fell asleep, he said, you have to get dressed. You have to get dressed. Now is the time. You must be dressed.
Amen.
You
Hallelujah.
Must be dressed.
Bless God.
You must be
yes.
in these things
yes.
that God is affording
yes.
to us to stand in and be. Mm-hmm. Hallelujah. You can go home and listen to a song called Love So Great. I know you know it. But then... we were going to use How Great Is Our God, but we're going to close with this song, Wonders, Deverly. We're going to bless God, stand, and bless his name. You can just praise him, think about what you're listening to, and then we will receive our offering as this song finishes.
No power of darkness. just open your heart. 'Cause through every trial life state, I will be nothing but faithful, 'cause I am your God. I am your God. And I have come to take off every limit, and I need you to stand up in the fire.
Father, we receive these tithes and these offerings that have come into this place today. You are worthy, Lord God, of the love and obedience of your truth. We thank you, O God, for your faithfulness is not unknown to us. But Lord, you want to show us even more. Yes. You wanted us to take off every limit, because yes, you want us to stand up in all kinds of places.
Yes. Hallelujah.
That you may purify and cleanse us more. So that these things are released from every form or shape of bondage or darkness that would still try to hold against your church, not only this, but the body of Christ all over the world.
Hallelujah.
That your kingdom will prosper, Lord God, hallelujah, and your people will always hold these testimonies that we have sung here and that we have heard in this place today. We bless your name. Thank you, Jesus, for your blood. Thank you for your name. Thank you for the constant place that you hold for us at the right hand of the Father. Thank you that we can walk in and see and know you, and you walk with us. Thank you, Holy Spirit, with such a powerful work that you are unclothing and putting on anew, Lord God, for these days and for these hours, Lord God, that darkness will not prevail, that light will stand outside of darkness and shine and call all things unto your throne. We give you praise in Jesus' name. Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah.